Thank you very much for coming to the first ever Bay Area Apache Flink meetup. We're really, really grateful to have this meetup in Bay Area, especially for Apache Flink. It's been in out for a while, but this is the first ever meetup in Bay Area. So my name is Henry Saputra. I am one of the organizers for the Apache Flink Bay Area meetup, and also happen to be BMC for Apache Flink. And today we're going to talk about Apache Flink. And so it is a top-level Apache Software Foundation project. The element of which is the generic distributed framework to unify both streaming and batch data processing. Originally come from a strategy project, some of you may have heard it before. It comes from coordination from Uber and a couple other organizations that try to improve what MapReduce have done before. And today we are very, very fortunate to have a very good speaker. Three of the members from the strategy project that contributed the project into Apache Flink Foundation as Apache Flink into incubator. Tonight we have Robert Metzger, also project member committee and incubator for Apache Flink, also founder engineer for a company, startup data artisans, that actively developed the Apache Flink. And next one we have Costa Stolas back. Happens to be also PMC member and creator for Apache Flink, and also happens to be CEO for DataArtisan, a company that's focused on Apache Flink. And we also have Stefan on the back. He's also PMC member and creator for Apache Flink, and also happens to be CEO of DataArtisan, the company that worked full time on Apache Flink. So we are going to have an awesome talk tonight. We are very fortunate to have a deep core knowledge of Apache Flink talk tonight. And we also want to say thank you very much for Pressure Data to helping us tonight, sponsorship and provide us the opportunity to meet tonight. And Kyoto will have something to say a little bit to welcome us in the meetup.
Hi everyone. I'll keep this one short because I'm not really technical. Every second that I'm here, I'm calling a lot of people up. So, how many people have heard of Treasure Data? Don't be shy. 1, 2, 3. We're in a happy audience. You don't have to admit that you learned about us today. So, Treasure Data, in one sentence, we provide analytics infrastructure simplified as a cloud service. And companies like Pebble, a whole bunch of startups, Wish.com, use us, our service, to make it super easy for data engineers and data scientists to get along and work happily together and get business results. So without further ado, I'll pass the microphone to Robert, and this is gonna be awesome. So, round of applause.
Thanks for the introduction. So yeah, as Henry already said, my name is Robert Metzger. I'm an EMC member of the Apache Flink project. I work at Data Artists, a company which is committed to develop Apache Flink in the open. I think half a year ago we started the Apache Flink meetup in Berlin, and over time it developed into a very great community there. So we have monthly meetups there, and I usually start the meetup with the community update. So in Berlin the community update is mostly about what happened in the last month. In this case, there wasn't a previous meetup, so I'm going to do a little like an extended community update today that will cover basically the last half year, so everything that happened in 2015 in Apache Flink. To put everything a bit more into perspective, as Henry already said, Apache Flink originates from the Stratosphere project. It was a research project started at the Technical University in Berlin in 2009. And in April 2014, we proposed Apache Flink to the Apache Incubator. Only a few months afterwards, in December 2014, the Apache board decided to turn it into a top-level project. This talk is going to start from exactly that moment, so from the acceptance as a top-level project of the foundation. And then I'll go through the events. You see the system stack of the system in the slide. So you see when we submitted the project there, it was rather small, so we had the core runtime, dataset API for batch processing, a few deployment options, fast forward to now, you see we have a really big stack with a lot of projects on top, more APIs, more deployment options, a lot of great stuff that happened. Alright, so as I've already said, in December 2014, the project was accepted as a top-level project within Apache, which means that the project can do their own releases, accept new committers, accept new PMC members. Also, Apache acknowledged that we are a healthy community which is able to sustain itself without relying on external dependencies like one company. We had more than 75 contributors at that point. I think by now we are at like 120 or so. In January, we had the 0.8 release of Apache Flink, which was kind of a maintenance release. Contained a lot of stability improvements. We added a Scala API for Flink streaming. And we added and improved the windowing semantics in Flink. So the streaming system of Flink allows you to specify windows very in a flexible way. Yeah, and some more features. In February, we started to speed up for the 0.9 release. The table API was added, which is a SQL-style abstraction on top of Flink, so you can, within the Java API and also the Scala API, specify, for example, filters very simple, and the system will generate code to execute that efficiently. We added Jelly, the graph processing API, to the main code, so it has been developed from outside contributors on GitHub, and we accepted the code into the main Bing source. And from February on, we further developed Jelly on the master. And the Apache Samoa project also started to integrate with Apache Flink. So this means that you can also do machine learning on data streams, not only on fixed batch datasets. In March, Google announced the dataflow runner. So Google has this dataflow API for batch and stream processing. And you don't have to use Google's cloud for running applications implemented against that API. You can also use Flink on-premise for free to run these jobs. And we started working on Flink ML machine learning library for Flink. Then, in that month we also published, or you put some effort into documenting the internals of Flink. So if you're interested in contributing or if you want to understand what the engine actually does with your job, these links are very helpful for getting some insights on how the system works. I will also share the slides on SlideShare so you can actually click the links this evening or tomorrow. Alright, in April we did a milestone release of the 0.9 version, which is kind of a preview of the 0.9 release, because we wanted to give our users a chance to try out all these new features, all these changes, as early as possible to get feedback. So we also changed a lot of internals, like the distributed communication, and also the on the batch side we changed a lot how we represent individual data sets. So that's something we wanted to bring out with people. Some contribution that came out of nothing, so nobody knew about it, it just popped up as a new pull request, was actually a smart compatibility layer. So somebody sat down and started to implement some code that allows you to run existing Storm code on Flink streaming. So if you have existing code for Storm, you can use that with Flink. We also added a Scala shell, so you can also do these interactive queries in Flink. And we merged the experimental Python API with Flink. If you're a Python developer and you know Java, I think this is a great opportunity to contribute and enhance. Google is paying us three students this summer to work on the project, and we give three students the opportunity to work on a great open source project. So we have a student working on distributed pattern matching in Flink, we have a student working on statistics in streams, and a student working on asynchronous iterations. In May, Somebody also previously unknown to the community started working on the Scala API for Jelly. Jelly is the graph processing API of Flink, so I can now do this both with Scala and Java. And May is also the time when more and more meetup groups started to pop out of nothing into the map of meetups. So in Stockholm, we have a meetup group. I think they had yesterday their second meetup. In Budapest was a meetup. We have the Berlin meetup group, and more are coming. We also updated the Flink website. It reflects a bit better what the system is doing. It's a bit more interactive, so it has, for example, the latest tweets, the blog posts, and so on. So check out the website if you want to learn more about the Flink project. In June, we are very happy that the Zeppelin project actually implemented support for Zeppelin for Flink, so you can use Zeppelin for interactive notebook-style ad hoc data analysis with Apache Flink. So you can do like a group by, and then it will immediately show you your data. Something more for the core. We also added static code analysis for the optimizer, so this allows the Flink optimizer to do better optimizations. So you need to supply, you can supply the optimizer with hints on what your user-defined function is doing with the data, and with this change, the system is able to give you hints on how to set these annotations. And the Chicago meetup group started, I think, for the first event there. I think it's scheduled for the end of the month. They have like more than 85 signups, so thumb up. This is a screenshot of Flink and Zeppelin, so here you can see how it looks, how it presents itself. And the whole theme of the last month were the 0.9 release, which is currently being voted on, so it should be out in the next 1 or 2 weeks. And this release is, I think, the biggest release that we ever had in Flink feature-wise. It adds 3 new APIs on top of Flink, so you have the machine learning library, the graph processing library, and the table API for SQL-style operations. We also enhanced the internals, so for example, Yarn has single job support and container restart. It also supports security, care workspace authentication, I think also for HTTPS. We have support for running Flink on Apache test for resource elasticity on Yarn, and we replaced our internal RPC system with Akka. But the main two things we spent most of the time on is actually the last 2 points. So we added support for fault tolerance in streaming in a very lightweight way. I think the talk of Costas will explain in detail how we implemented this. And for the batch side, we reworked how we represent results of intermediate results of the operators, which allows a lot of stuff like these interactive shells and fault tolerance in batch. Alright, and for closing up the community update, I want to give some pointers on how to connect with the Flink community. So there are the mailing lists, the news.flink.apache.org mailing list is very low traffic, it's probably 1 or 2 emails per month. And then user is a bit more traffic, dev is high traffic. Another convenient way of following the project is Twitter. We have our blog, and more meetup groups are appearing all over the world. So if you're interested to start a local meetup group, do it, or join this meetup group and give talks here, and so on. Another great way to connect with the Apache Flink community is Flink Forward, a conference that is happening in Berlin in October. So there we will have a 2 days conference in a great location, with tutorials for Flink and a lot of interesting talks, both from industry but also committers, users, everything. And I think that's it, yes. So now I would like to hand over to Costas, who's going to give an introduction on Apache Flink, including a demo by Stefan on how to use Flink streaming. If there are any questions, please go ahead.
So they are purely logical handles to stream of records but maybe strings to the system, or maybe custom memory, disk, and so on. And of course, other operators can go and consume these intermediate results. Okay, let's look at a very, very simple example, right? So let's look at MapReduce. If you write a MapReduce total thing, so we say dataset.MapReduce, then the system is going to create something that is called an execution graph. Essentially, it has all of these operators that give results and execute that. The master knows about the complete history of the job, so that in the case of failure, the job can be recounted. Yeah. So the way it works is that we have here two workers, we call them task managers, that have map tasks and reduce tasks. The map tasks are going to start to produce some data and put them in what we call the result partitions. So let's look at exactly the first mapper that produces result partition 1. This partition is going to tell sort of the master that, hey, I'm ready. If anybody's interested in me, I'm here. And then the master is going to notify the two possible consumers, so reducer 1 and reducer 2, which are going to open a connection in this case with another task manager and start grabbing data. So if you know on a very high level how MapReduce works, this is basically the same thing, but there is one crucial difference. If this intermediate result partition, RP1, makes itself available, says I'm ready, as soon as, let's say, the first buffer is produced, then you can model a streaming data instance using that. Yeah, this is what we usually call like pipelined data samples. If this result partition says I'm ready, if it waits until the whole data has been produced, it's put a file or it's put in memory somewhere, and then says I'm ready, then you model what people usually call batch data exchange. What you would, so the pipeline or stream data exchange, you would find in systems like Apache Store or DataTorrent, or assume a batch data exchange you would find in systems such as Hadoop, Test, or MapReduce Test, Spark, and so on. So by abstracting this away and making this a logical handle rather than a concrete implementation of the intermediate result, you can actually have a system that can natively do both. Yeah? So there are many implementations, so there are two essential implementations of this link. And this is basically the way that the system is designed to support natively both pipelined data samples, or which are used to support data streaming, and batch data samples, which are optionally used to support, batch analytics. These intermediate results can also be ephemeral, so they can be consumed once and then die, or they can be checkpointed for recovery, later reused, etc. So the runtime of the system down at the bottom is quite a flexible runtime that is designed to support a bunch of use cases on top. Let me focus for a moment on this stuff, the data streaming. Pipeline data exchange essentially means that if I have a program like this, where I have a source task, let's say a tokenizer and a window card, pipelining means that all of these tasks are basically brought up once the whole topology is scheduled, and then they just keep running, and they can be running for months, you know, as long as the streaming job is running, and the data keeps being pushed through this operator. So this is basically a basic building block to support streaming. A common misconception is that these systems transfer data like one tuple at a time. So some people call this tuple at a time execution. That's usually not true. Most systems do some buffering. So they will collect a few records in a buffer and send that buffer. So Flink does exactly that, with the ability to specify also timeout if you want to control your latency and say, I would like everything to be sent after this timeout. Now the big thing in this data streaming world, and how things are very, very different from the classic batch world, is how we will achieve fault tolerance. And there are two main notions there, something that people call at least once during this, and something that we call exactly once during this. So at least once there are these means that essentially, in the case of failure, the operators are going to see every event. Yeah. So you're not going to lose anything. And exactly once typically means that when these operators maintain some state, they will not, in the case of failure, perform duplicate updates on this state. So if you have a counter that's counting 1, 2, 3, 4, in the case of failure, you're not going to see 6, you're going to see 5 that you would see without the failure. So for at least once, this is typically, so this is for example what storm guarantees, and this is typically solved by replaying a stream from an upstream backup, for example, if you would replay from a source from a past Kafka host. For exactly ones there are these, there are several solutions to achieve that. The three solutions that I know of are the following. The first one is called discretized streams. And that is, for example, what Spark Streaming is based on, and also, I believe, Triton and Storm. So the idea there is to treat stream computation as a series of atomic microbatch computations that either succeed or fail at their entirety. Yeah? And this is cool because it actually makes it very easy to get this exactly one guarantees, even by using a system underneath that uses classic recovery for batch processing. It comes with a bunch of restrictions. For example, it is hard to mutate state during the computation. It comes with latency restrictions, and essentially it does not separate the logic of the application with the recovery checkpoint. So the recovery checkpoint is also the grouping window of the application. A second approach to get over these limitations is used by Google Cloud Dataflow. That's in the Millwheel paper. And essentially there, what they do is that every incoming event on operator produces a bunch of derived events and some updates in the state. And all of this is grouped together and committed to a high-throughput processional store. This works, and it's great. The only problem is that you need to have a high-throughput processional store, which is something that Google has, so this is a managed service by Google. A lot of people don't. And the third way to do that is what we do with Flink, which is basically a variation of something Lambert distributed snapshots. The way this basically works is the following. You have here a streaming topology, so the yellow things are sources, the green things are operators. And initially, Flink is going to say, hey, going to start at checkpoint, which means that it's going to go to the sources and say, please give me the event that you're currently reading. These offsets, as they're called, are barriers. So these barriers will be registered at the master, and then they will start flowing, essentially through the topology, pushing the prior events in front of them. When a barrier arrives to the operator will start checkpointing itself. Yeah? So an operator will be either not being checkpointed yet, during a checkpoint, or will have finished a checkpoint. A checkpoint essentially means that the operator will take the state that has a counter, hashmark, whatever. You will actually see an example later in the demo, and write it out to a reliable data store. So currently, what Flink supports is an interface to do that for either the job manager, if you're just running locally, or you have a very small state, or a file system, say, it's the FS or Cache. And there are also ways to make these checkpoints actually incremental. The system does not do that yet. Right now, it's they're synchronous, and they're done in their entirety, but there is work to make them both asynchronous and incremental. So you can imagine actually a lot of these can be run at the same time, and the data keeps moving, so the data never stops flowing through the pipeline. One complication is that when you have many inputs, you need to wait for all the barriers to come, checkpoint your state, so you need to wait for all the updates to update your state for checkpointing. But in the end, so when all the barriers have flown through the policy, have reached the data sinks, and every operator says, I'm done, then you can signal this was a successful checkpoint. So at failure, in the case of failure at recovery, what you do is that you roll back your data sources to this last barrier that you recorded, and you roll back the operator state to the one that you checkpointed. And that gives you exactly is exactly once guarantees. And what's cool about that is that it actually gives you quite a few things at the same time. So first of all, because the engine is pipelined and the data never stops moving, so there's no notion of micro-batching and rescheduling, there's true low latency.
Okay.
The second thing is that the guarantee is strong, so it is exactly once inside the streaming system. The third is, because this checkpointing mechanism has actually pretty low overhead, and you can actually control this overhead by controlling the interval of the checkpoint, you can get high throughput from that. And something very important is that this checkpoint interval is just a parameter in a config file. So it never enters the application logic. So you can define your arbitrary windows, window your data by 2 seconds and checkpoint every 10 seconds, or window your data by some session type window and so on, and this still works. So it does separate the app logic from the recovery. Now, I said that I'll talk to you about stream processing. There's a lot more. These are some basic building blocks. Now, if you have a stream processor, the next question is, what can you do with that, okay? The most obvious thing that you can do with a stream processor is stream processing. And that's the first thing I'm going to talk about. A somewhat less obvious thing that you can do with a stream processor is batch processing. And that is actually a very good idea, and I will tell you why. And then, by enriching this model a bit and actually allowing feedback loops in the data flow, so rather than having a strict DAG, you allow a few cycles, you can actually very well model machine learning and graph analytics. And we have done all that in Flink at various levels, so some things have more development behind them than others, but all of these are very well possible, and the project also provides you the APIs to access these things. Okay, so the first one is stream data analytics. I'm not going to go into much detail about the API because the plan is actually that Stefan, exactly after me, is going to give you a demo and basically show you how it looks in real life. I'm just going to give you the basic idea. So the idea we're following here is that if you are used to systems like Spark or Sprouting and so on for batch processing, you should be able, first of all, to use Flink itself, and second, to transition very easily to stream process. So this is the, it's work done, sorry. I'm not a big fan either, but it's very easy to see that, you know, this is word count in the BATS API, the dataset API, and word count in the streaming API, the dataset API. And basically the difference is here is that you don't define something as a dataset, but as a data stream. You're not reading from a text file, but you're reading from a socket. Because this is an infinite stream, you are windowing it by here 5 seconds and triggering computation every 1 second, everything else the same. So the general philosophy is to make streaming accessible for people that come from bots. So gradually, during this talk, I'm going to try to build the Flink stack in a certain way. It is not in the same way that Robert actually presented, so it's not in a chronological order, but it's sort of in concept order, if you wish. So we have seen like the basic blocks of the streaming data flow runtime and the data stream API. The data stream API you can use embedded in Java and Scala. The next thing that you can do very well with the stream processor is batch data analytics. So if you think about it, batch processing is really a special case of streaming. Yeah? So when you're reading a file, what are you doing? You're streaming through the lines of this file. If you keep streaming through the lines of this file all the way to the end, through the operators, well, then you have processed your file, right? So even though it's a file, it was a processor. There are two main differences. The first one is that you don't have to go to all the trouble doing all these checkpoints during execution that I described before, because your input is finite, right? So if you have a failure at some point, you can just replay the whole thing, close this beginning and the end. And the Flink actually follows that, so it does not have the same code path for fault tolerance if you use a streaming API or the Apache API, so makes it balance of that. The next thing is that naturally batch processing has blocking operators. So if you do something like an aggregation or a join or a sort, this thing has to process all its input before it gives any output to the next operator. But that's actually not a problem because you can embed blocking operators inside the streaming topology. So in fact, what is happening here, what is happening with Flink, is that all of these things, let's say the data flow level, the arrows, don't know whether they're executing a streaming program or a batch program. It's only what is inside these circles that separate the two. So in fact, for the really at the runtime, a batch program and a streaming program look exactly the same. Another thing that is important when you're doing batch analytics, and something that was a major focus in the Flink project actually from the beginning before we went Apache, was what do you do when the memory runs out? Yeah, and that is a really big deal because when you're doing heavy batch pipelines, you typically don't have enough memory, you know, for all your concurrent jobs in the cluster. So what Flink did very early on is managed memory. Managed memory means that in the Flink workers, the task managers, the system tries very hard to not allocate Java objects, so it does not, tries to not rely on the garbage collector to the memory management, the JVM to the memory management, but does it itself. So it sort of has an implementation of a database buffer pool inside the system. It allocates batch arrays, and all the operators, like sorting, hashing, and so on, are implemented in a way to work with this managed memory rather than create new objects. So all the intermediate data lives in serialized form in managed memory. Now, the net effect of this, without going into details, is that when memory runs out, things get slower slowly. Okay, so you are not going to fall, you know, completely off a cliff, but you will see a gradual, you know, deterioration of your performance. Another thing is that you're not hit very often from garbage collection stalls, and so on. So in general, it gives you very robust execution. The next thing that is kind of different in batch processing and stream processing is how do you build up these data flows that I described before. So in batch processing, we can actually take advantage of all of these decades of tradition in relational databases and build a query optimizer. So Flink being a system that does not only do SQL, so does not only do all of the relational model, but also actually has user-defined functions as personal citizens, it cannot do the full-scale optimizations that are present in parallel databases, but it can do some of them. So what this optimizer that is present in Flink does is essentially pick physical execution operator, so it will pick should I execute this join as a hash join, as a hash join, or as a sort large join. It will look at partitioning and try to reuse partitioning. So for example, if a join already partitions the data and the subsequent reducer meets the same partitioning, then it's not going to be twice. And it's going to pick whether you're doing like a broadcast join, sometimes referred to as a map channel join, or a repartition join, sometimes referred to as a resign join. So it's going to pick a lot of this stuff automatically by taking a sample of the data and looking at the problem. There are hints that you can use to the optimizer to help actually arrive at these decisions. Okay, so gradually building the stack, I added the dataset API. On top of the dataset API, I think Robert mentioned that there's actually a Hadoop MapReduce compatibility packets where you can just throw in your MapReduce functions. There's something that is called the table API. The table API, I think of it as logical tables with attributes, so you don't have to go into all the trouble of defining Java classes, Scala case classes, and so on when you're doing joins, but you can just do them and refer to attributes by their name. I added at the bottom a bunch of deployment options, so you can run Flink locally. If you're debugging, you can run it in a standalone Flink cluster. You can run it on YARN. That's very, very common. There is a mode to run it on YARN by using tests for scheduling and sampling. This is interesting if you are if you want dynamic elasticity, so if you want your DAG to scale in and out dynamically depending on what other people are requesting from the YARN cluster. And there's also an embedding mode that basically sidesteps the whole runtime, just runs it as a Java operation program. And just finally, last thing, I mentioned this before, another thing that you can do very well in the stream processor if you add some capabilities for feedback loops is iterative processing. Now, iterative processing typically manifests itself in two use cases. One is machine learning. There is an ongoing effort in the Flink project, which has the name Flink Label, to build something like a machine learning toolkit on top of the dataset API. This provides an API for creating this sort of pipelines where you are chaining transformers, learners, etc. And also a suite of rebalanced algorithms. And this is currently available in Scala. And Jelly is the name. So the second use case that iterations are typically very useful is graph processing. Jelly is a graph library and API on top of the system that essentially gives you a data type called a graph. So instead of having to work with data sets and joins, you just have something that's called a graph and you run graph operations on top of that. And it comes also with a bunch of prepackaged operations. What is cool about these two libraries is so they are backed by a very unique mechanism in Flink that actually builds feedback loops inside the data flow. So instead of relying on the driver to create a for loop and submit jobs one after the other in the cluster, this is actually done internally by the system. This means that this is also integrated in the optimizer. So the optimizer can go and see, hey, I'm actually executing an iteration, I know that. This part of the program is loop invariant, this part of the program is in the loop. I can cast that automatically, I can push this sort out of the loop if possible, so it can do all that stuff, all that cool stuff, as it knows that this is an iterative job. And the other cool thing is that these iterations scale well. So because these are, and because of the general system characteristics, one artifact here is testing once that's iterative job and trying to scale it out. So this is ALS, alternating mean squares. This is using, remind me, 40 machines, a cluster of 40 machines in Google Compute. The idea is to scale this matrix factorization to a large number of ratings. So in the end, Flink was able to complete the job with 28 billion ratings in 5 hours using the largest Google Compute machines that there are. This is a big data set, so some of you might be working at web companies that have this kind of data set. Just one frame of reference. A number that was reported officially by Netflix 3 years ago was 5 million ratings. I'm sure they're more by now. But it's really an inherent scale problem. And just to finish off, we have gradually built the stack from the bottom up. So, as I said, Flink is a stream processor. It can manifest itself in two ways using the Apache API and the Stream API. Both come very naturally when you have a stream processor. On top of this, what is also natural is to build libraries to make it work easier for people and for practitioners. The other nice thing is seeing other projects integrate and compile them with Flink. Some of these are based on the slide, but yeah, this is like the full stack right now. And just to tell you what I told you, so I try to. Make a case. So I think stream processing is going to become more and more important in the future. I see a lot of people deploying things like Kafka to the other event streams. The next thing that these people are going to need is a stream processor. There are many out there. Think Flink is a good one, and I think it's a good one for the combination of the following reasons. First, you can actually get the low latency. You can get high throughput as you can configure your checkpoint interval and use a low overhead checkpointing mechanism. You get this very nice example one scarcity that people want. And in addition to that, you get all of those components that comes with easy to use APIs, especially if you're coming from mass processing, the library ecosystem, so on. And as Robert mentioned, a growing developer community. That was my first point. Second point was that if you have that, if you have a processor, that's actually a very good case, a very good match for batch processing as well. So there are very good use cases for this. So you can use, in the end, one system for both. Yes. And then it is time for Stefan to show you exactly how you can do, or how you can take a Q&A for that. Yeah.
So how do you deal with, you mentioned that there's a pipeline execution engine. How do you deal with data dependency, especially like the data on that? You know the pipeline, right?
Sorry, say that again?
How do you deal with data dependency when you try to pipeline your execution? You know, in pipelining, for example, data on that. So I mean, if you have a lot of your if there is a use case, there are a lot of data dependency, it will be very hard to pipeline.
Yeah, so by data dependency, okay, so the question is if you're pipelining, how do you deal with data dependencies? I'm not sure exactly what you mean by data dependency. So pipelining has its use case. There are times that you want to actually pipeline, and there are times that you want to do batch samples. Yeah. So, for example, let me think. If you have very long pipelines, then you might actually be putting just a little bit of memory to every sample. Yeah. So then you would actually want to write to execute that the thing in a stage way. So the way you do that is that you actually, so the way Flink does that is that it actually supports both pipeline and batch samples. And it does that by this mechanism, by making this intermediate data set exactly be able to get two implementations, one pipeline and one load.
So you alternate selecting the
barrel
that
Yes. Okay, so it's very similar to the database system implementation, whereby the task manager, the worker, allocates memory up front. It's very similar to the database system implementation in Java. It's weird. But you basically allocate a lot of memory up front in the form of byte arrays. All the intermediate data lives in serialized form in these byte arrays. For that, the system has its own type extraction stack that actually generates serializers, comparators, and so on. Yeah. And then all the internal algorithms, like hashing and sorting, operate directly on this byte array. So in many, many cases, when you sort, you don't need to deserialize on there. And the reserialize, but you operate directly on this byte array. Now, when the data is such form, you know exactly what you're going to run with data about memory, and you know exactly how you can destage to this and bring it back to this. Essentially, it uses external memory algorithm. So, if you're doing a sort, it's going to fall back to an external sort. If you're doing a hash join, it doesn't use like a Java hash map, but it uses an adaptive hash join as implemented in many database systems. That is the basic
definition.
Exactly, recursive, yeah.
Is there a way for the user to, first for your system to determine the optimal window size? And the other question is, how do you determine the granularity of your operator?
Okay, so the first question was, is it possible for the system or the user to determine the optimal window size? So if by window size you mean, like when I had this example that said datastream.window every 5 seconds,
yeah.
That is actually up to the application. Yeah. So and some applications will want to buffer, you know, so many seconds. So it's up to the application developer. It's not a system parameter.
Ingest the data might be an incoming data streaming might be at a different kind of data rate, you know. Some might be constant or near constant, but a lot of times there are a lot of spike.
Yeah, and that is a completely separate concern from the window size, okay. Right? So this is basically flow control and backwards.
How about a second question? In terms of granularity of operator?
So granularity of operators, meaning the parallelism, that is again up to the user, right?
Okay.
Yes. So the system will not try to say, hey, I think this job should run with parallelism of 50.
With the speed that the data is ingested into Kafka, then it will just store the elements within Kafka. So as soon as the peak goes down again, Flink will just continue reading from Kafka until it is on the current offset again.
Yeah, I think the question also goes further, right? So if the target where you want to put the data in cannot keep up with the spike, right? So if your operation in the data sink that tries to inject it somewhere cannot complete any faster because this one is slow, then this is there is a certain amount of buffering that happens between operators and Flink, but at some point in time this buffering is exceeded, then it's only back pressure to the source. So if you have transient spikes that are like very short, the chances are good you can just get lost inside Flink's internal buffering. If you have a spike for a longer time, and the sync cannot keep up, at some point in time you will just start consuming slower from Kafka because there's really no way to put the data.
Yeah, but this is that's the thing, unless this is like strong, right? Like it's really hard to put that pressure.
Yeah.
Because it goes on to the source in that case. So as I said, in both cases, sometimes what happens is you update something in Kafka, there's a huge offset that you start getting from. Or even if stream processing can be very CPU bound, then you know they can't just keep up with the rate at which the Kafka is. So are there any kind of like inbuilt mechanisms like where you can memory management to detect that back or situation if you can point string?
Okay, so
Stefan, do you want to come on stage? Should we have it under the video recording?
We can take it offline but
yeah.
But I think it's interesting. So the way that Flink is built is the operators naturally back pressure onto each other, right? So whenever a downstream operator cannot keep up, it's going to back pressure the upstream operators. At some point in time, it's upstream operators going to be the source, and the source is not going to back pressure Kafka by itself, right? Because Kafka's idea is exactly not to be that, but to be sort of infinitely elastic. So we'll back pressure from the sink all the way to the source, all the way to the, let's say, Kafka consumer, but we'll not back pressure Kafka itself. Is the question, is there a mechanism to back pressure into Kafka?
No, it's not like you would back pressure into Kafka, but can you avoid this kind of situation? Because you know, you can't literally that there is that situation when I'm not in the sink, right?
Talking modern.
And I mean, there are ways that I'm not an expert in it, like I run into the that are kind of advice would be much more smart about handling
Yeah.
There's lots of ways of doing it, I think. But.
Yeah, so the, I mean, Flink itself, I said this before, vectors itself pretty well. So you're not going to run inside the system out of memory, out of buffers or anything, just because there's going to be spikes and variations in the throughput.
So do you expose these kind of metrics again
Okay, so the, let's say latency and throughput and so on, these spikes, we're actually not exposing them at this point in time. We're currently reworking the web-based virtualization of the runtime to exactly expose those.
I actually see
this in the demo. I'll have them on the command line for now, but we're working on actually bringing them in a factory.
I think that is solve the problem. It should not be up to the responsibility of the engine. It should be the front end. I mean, you know, or you should build your own system to handle that kind of situation. Otherwise, your system or your engine become more and more generic. That's not a good idea. You cannot handle everything.
Oh, by the way, if you currently want to detect such situations, I think the Kafka monitoring interface allows you to do that. You can see, because Flink vector is the source, and if then the ingestion into Kafka is higher than, let's say, your end system to which you ingest can keep up with, then you're going to see that Flink will eventually fall behind to consuming from Kafka because it gets back pressure from the end all the way through. So you're going to see this in the Kafka monitoring. So that's so much better we're seeing today.
So recently they have the same issue with the spot when they implement the receiver. So they implement the direct contact, which is they come down the receiver server. So directly they are persisting it at the contact for recovery. And then another way they implement this kind of situation is that you can bring more node. Because ultimately how much you can input you must be able to process it. So the only way you can have that is bringing more nodes.
Yes, you can do dynamic scale out, exactly.
So the thing doesn't happen, right? And
So Flink doesn't have dynamic scale out right now, but we are working on it.
The question you had, the problem was that ultimately the final target of the data is not going to keep up with it, right?
Yes, let's say you're supposed to say data stores are not, you're doing more updates on the data stores, and then never going to be as fast as your stream processing ever, right?
Yeah.
Maybe you rewrite up cycle as well, and that never ever going to be faster than or you keep up with your stream.
But what would be a solution to that? I mean, this thing cannot scale out because your database doesn't all of a sudden.
I think push-based is the problem. Most probably, it looks like we're trying to write into a Kafka and trying to do a pool. But that has its own problems, right? That means all your data sources need to know how to pull from Kafka rather than directly just using the
right. Yeah, that makes sense. How do you use user control? You can control the parallelism of every operator independently. You can, just say run everything with the sort of default parallelism. You can bring up the job and send the job for every operator individually.
Yeah.
And we will use this parallelism for the lifetime of the job. Since you create these topologies programmatically inside, you can use whatever function you want to determine this, but it, like Robert said, it's not depending on low throughput or on falling behind the latency or something like that.
For the static parallelism that is put on what control is that when you look inside which portion of the data is on which position. You can implement a custom partitioning function, but there's no way, no notion of doing any load balancing between operators.
Actually, there is mechanics specific scale balance at this point. But so if you look at the APIs, I'm going to give you an example later. Most of the time, you're not concerning yourself with exactly where does a record go, or it is up to the, let's say, high level operation to decide the form of routing. I mean, think about it in MapReduce and Spark, you're usually not writing partition by something now. You can do this, but most of the times you're saying, apply me some operation on a key or on a key or window or so, and this implicitly implies that the system will have to make sure that it's routed to
partitions based on that key unless it is already partitioned on that key. So these operations ultimately parameterize the partitioner in more cases than you can many times in development. Yeah, okay, so...
Can you repeat your question?
Okay, so he was asking about a very, very fine-grained way of reading data streams. Let's say you have two data streams and you have an operator that works on, if I understand this correctly, on both of these streams, on the union of them, or on, it's a dual bullet operator. And you want to partition on one stream based on some function, on the other one you want to partition on a completely different function. In order to lose. Yeah, I mean, you can always do this with just inserting your own partition function. Or you can, I mean, in the case that you gave for the second stream, you want all the data to go to that one, that would be just a stream broadcaster, a target operator, and the other one would be, let's say, a stream match partition. So you can pretty flexibly combine those, yeah.
I'm not sure you are aware of single pointer or failure or not, but that's not a big deal. My question is that you have both local mode and custom mode. Now for custom mode, how do you deal with a situation like a cluster is on a public cloud, which is less reliable, or in a on a private cloud, like an own data center, and much more reliable or less responsive? Do you distinguish those different kind of scenarios?
So about the
cluster or you know, the underlying infrastructure robustness as well as resilience, a lot of issues.
Okay, so the question is, are there different forms of handling, whether you run on, let's say,
data center and
data center infrastructure or in a public cloud where we use some different sort of like reliability. So this, I assume what you mean is this manifests itself in different failure rates, right?
Yes.
So are there any special ways of handling different failure? Actually, right now, no, there aren't. So what we assume is that when a node goes down, you want to bring up a replacement node. For example, if you use it on yarn, it's going to monitor those. As soon as one disappears, it's going to actively try and start up a new one and take this into the cluster again. Yeah. So if you use it on...
So right now, it's up to the user's response. It's manual, right? Your system does not handle those kind of situations. Even
it doesn't make a distinction between the two, right? It handles both in the same way. So, yeah.
So what kind of frame sizes are you seeing relative to Storm? So Storm, obviously, you create the graphs and all that. You know, it's mainly meant for like counting things, smaller jobs. What kind of frame sizes being like an individual job size, what kind of frame sizes are you seeing right now?
Okay, so how complex do individual jobs get?
Right.
Okay, for streaming, they tend to be much simpler than for batch program. Actually, so we have a few screenshots from the Flink visualization of batch programs where you can, because it is a data flow, you can also just send that down a visual representation of that. And I had something on my laptop. For the batch programs, they go like, you scroll across six screens and very little bubbles in order to actually look at that. So for batch, they tend to get ridiculously big. For streaming, actually not that much. No. I mean, we're not seeing everybody uses it, but the people that use it, I don't know, maybe 5-6 operations or so far.
So what else? So I guess like entering an overflow, obviously, where every few records can be used. So what I'm asking about are the bigger features. If you're streaming examples in, like how big do you see those getting more? Or how big do you see those getting? Sure.
So ML workloads tend to be slightly bigger. So, you know, you're typically running your data pipeline and then you're sending data over the network, right?
Yep.
So how big are those workloads how big are the workloads that you've seen so far that could be like that?
I mean, how big in terms of what is the size of an individual record that goes through?
Individual streams.
Okay.
I mean, an individual stream can, over all elements, go into the, of course, into the many terabytes or so. And for ML workloads, this example of alternating these squares that Costos gave there has a single record that it ships. It's a sub portion of the matrix of, I think, 560 megabytes. So it handles fairly large frames, actually, very well. It has actually internally some specialized code paths for exactly receiving and recomposing these very large records to make sure these, because if you're recomposing them in parallel, you easily just kill all your memory if you start, if you do a, let's say, an external sort on very large records and you try to merge them with a too high fan in, this is going to blow your heap size and so on. So it actually has specialized code paths in the software system to handle very large records.
So my question is mostly we kind of experimented with using Spark streaming, and typical use case for us is you always have like an online stream, but when you have to make a decision, you have to look at some historical data and then kind of make the decision and then write back this for future computations. Most systems do not give a good performant way of like reading data on the fly from a data store. Because always streaming always is assumed that you're reading from a Kafka stream or something. But most often you also need some historical data to make the decision, right? So what's the story of reading that kind of data in Flink? To give the parallelism in Spark, we have this update state by key API that you could use to kind of keep adding on to that state information that you goes as you process. So is there a solution for that in Flink, or is it something totally different? Like Sansa in a way does that very differently. It has a local, like a RocksDB store where you can use for state management. So what is the story in Flink?
Okay, so the story is let me repeat the question and make sure I understood it correctly. You said when you're processing streams, you're not just looking at an individual record in isolation, you're also referring to state that you computed over the past. Actually, you're going to see that in the demo. The state is, I think the state handling in Flink is probably the most flexible one that you have right now, because it's not bound to be inside some database, inside some IP RDD or so. You can interact with any key value store, so it's very simple. You can just keep it in your regular operator or in your user object and just make the system aware of this data, so you can take care of snapshotting it and restoring it and keeping it consistent with respect to exactly once guarantees and so on. So this is really very easy.
Is that fault tolerance built into that? Like, for instance, if I use an external store,
I'm going to show this in the demo in a bit. The fault tolerance includes actually hooks into the user code that can snapshot parts of the user code as well, or the user code state. If you want to do this with an external store, you can right now do this, I think, by making the user code receive the snapshot commit messages and so on, and communicating this with this outside store. This way you can actually interact with that in a proper way. I say, okay, I'm giving you data, I'm now making it, let's say, visible to, as soon as I know I'm through one of these snapshots and I'm confident that this is going to stay. We're working on actually exposing this in a nicer way, so that you can basically just plug in external state backends much easier and say, okay, here's an HBase adapter for state, and it's going to take part in the distributed snapshotting. This is what we're working on for the next question. Yeah.
Can I just one more question?
Sure. Yeah.
So, can your system also run on both bare metal and on container?
Yeah, it runs on. I mean, we work with developers on bare metal clusters usually, but on containers. I mean, containers we like.
And what is the largest size of a single cluster in terms of number of nodes right now? Your system can run. And what causes that sort of bottleneck? What kind of effects causes that bottleneck?
That's a good question. So we have honestly not tried more than 200 nodes so far. That was the largest cluster that we could get ourselves hands on to do, let's say, conclusive tests.
No, just roughly, like several thousand, several hundred, or hundred.
The
single cluster.
Yeah. So the. I think for simple jobs you can probably get much higher. I would assume the bottleneck in the end becomes the limiting factor becomes the scalability of the shuffle, because the shuffle usually is in terms of number of producers and number of consumers. There is some quadratic component in there that at least you have to be able to dedicate one memory buffer to each of these quadratic bits, right? So yeah, if you have a cluster with good memory, I would assume you can easily get this to 1,000 and more. You just have to, at some point, increase the number of network buffers so that the communication fabric can manage this number of connections. So we have not ourselves gotten a cluster to hit this limit. That's all I can say. But at the same time, we're not Yahoo Netflix or Spotify or so. I'm not saying that people will not get this. It's hard to say. We'd love to hear it from somebody. You know, I think this limit has on so many notes and so many words. I'd love to hear it. Okay. Okay, it's a pretty simple and rough demo that we just hacked together. But I hope it's going to give you a bit of an impression of what it feels like to use Flink for streaming. Give me a second. Cool, the resolution's actually good. Can you read it, or?
A little bigger,
okay. That's one of the nicest features of intelligent presentation. Okay, so what we're seeing here is the, let's say, the minimal skeleton of a streaming job. We're going to write streaming jobs just as regular Java programs, or Scala programs here. By the way, I'm doing this in Scala, hope everybody's okay with that.
Yeah.
Otherwise, I'll have to improvise it. We start with the main method, and then the first thing you do is you get the execution environment. The execution environment defines where this thing and how this thing is executed. So in this case, I'm getting a stream execution environment. If I want to work in the let's say pure batch mode, I'm getting a batch execution environment. This call get execution environment is actually a call that tries to pick up the context. So if I'm submitting it to a cluster, it picks up the execution environment of a cluster. If I'm just running it from the IDE without having any cluster config present, and so then it's going to spawn a local host to execute that. I can also explicitly essentially in other environments. And this execution environment object controls sort of the core parameters of the execution, the snapshot into moments, the let's say default parallelism and other configuration parameters. So the first thing to do once I have this, by the way, I'm setting parallelism here to 54, it's a bit lame, but the end in which this one is only a 4 core, so yeah, we're going to start with 4 here. First thing to do is actually create a sample stream, so we're adding a source to the environment, and this is producing a stream. And for a start, I'm just using a generator that creates this stream. I'm letting on this virtual Kafka, but for now, I'm just using this this generator here. So the a source function that you generate is pretty simple. It really just has a run method and a cancel method. And in this case, I've implemented it such that it generates me a series of events. Oh, we haven't really talked about the demo scenario. Okay, so let me step back one step. So what the idea behind this scenario is, it's something that is a very simple example of doing event pattern detection. So we're generating events that resemble something like, let's say events generated from network infrastructure. There's an event once a certain once certain frames reach a firewall and get rejected, once certain user authenticated Kerberos, once somebody interacts with the application server in some way. Let's assume this all generates some events, and then we have a set of rules that form a state machine that describe in which order these events are supposed to happen. Right? So if we see, let's say we've seen an interaction with some service before having seen an interaction with the authentication service, that there may be a hacker at work or so, right? So this is the very rough idea. So it's a sequence of events, and I'm looking for whether these are following a well-behaved form pattern, right? And this is actually being in some sense a stateful computation, because you're looking at a record and you're comparing it with what you have seen in the past. This is actually fit that. Okay, so what this generator source here is generating is something very simple. Let me actually ask you art for the state machine. Maybe I should show that. That may help illustrate it.
Can you make the phone size bigger?
Okay. Here we go. So for this simple scenario, I'm just assuming a certain flow of events. You start from basically an initial state, given a certain event, you enter another state, and at some point you reach a terminal state. You can also cycle at some point in time. But yeah. We're looking for illegal state transitions, and once we see an illegal state transition of an event, the current state not being what we expected to be, then we generate an alert. Think of it as something that goes to the dashboard and says, okay, you know what, here's something funny going on. Alright, so that is what this data source is generating here. Okay, let's actually have a look at this, what is in this, at the sample stream. So the easiest way to do this is just say print. And let me tell this is working. At this point, we've defined all the operations we want to do in the stream, and let's just execute this. So let me run this real quick and keep your fingers crossed. I'm on the development snapshot version. I'm not sure how many bugs and unfixed bugs are currently in there. So, yeah, it's a... Let's see if it works. So it's bringing up a small Flink cluster in the background. Okay, and this is basically what this stream here generates. Event, this is, in this simple example, let's say source IP address. And this is a code for an interaction. In this case, it means, let's say, the interaction with the Kerberos or sort of authentication. This IP address has received it sends sort of an event to that service. Okay, the next thing that we want to do is have a look at what web patterns this follows. So the state machine that I have there is I use it at the same time to generate events, and I think once every 10 million I'm injecting an illegal state transition, and I want to write a stream program that actually recognizes illegal state transitions and generates an alert. And so the first thing we need to do is if we run this with a parallelism of 4, we want to make sure that all the events from the same IP address actually go different to the same node, because that's where we maintain the state machines. So the first thing we do is basically partition this. This is a case of I'm using the case of a manual partitioning right now, so I'm partitioning it by hash code. And the way we do that exactly, let me increase the font size in a second again, is we're using these high level API descriptions here, these high level type descriptions. So The types that go through the system are actually here. These types are just Java case and Scala case classes. It's an event, source IP address, encoded as an int, and then event type as a special type. And an alert from an address having a state and a transition that is considered DB. Okay, so I want to partition this on the source address. So what I tell the system is exactly that partition of the source address. So before the program goes to the execution, Costas showed it in the graph before, it's going to go to this type analysis and type extraction. So it's going to figure out, okay, source address is the first part of the tuple. This tuple
is it a case class that can actually represent this as a true tuple of Y or not? It's a prepared serializable that whenever something is going to refer to someone's address, it's actually it's not raised that refers to the first 4 bytes. That's what this in the end points out. Okay, hard partition it by hash, and then I'm going to pipe the events that are say co-located by this address to my state machine. And for that I'm just going to use a simple function of netmap. I'm going to move something here to make it easier for the search. Easier to grasp. Okay, this is just the source function. It's going to maintain some state over the operation, which is just a hash map here from the IP address from int to the state object. And whenever an event comes, it grabs the current state from this the last event, the state that I think is interaction with the source address is in. If I don't have any interaction yet, I'm going to assume it's an initial state. I let the state transition based on the event, and if I'm seeing an invalid transition, then I'm collecting the alert. Otherwise, I remember the latest state. So this is just what evaluates the state machine. So. Very good at coding with one hand. Sorry. Okay, yeah. So this is let's say the simple streaming program that we start with for now. If you look at it in the distributed data flow sense, or if you look at the topology, what this boils down to is 3 operations: the source that takes the event, or in this case generates it, and also routes it based on this field, and then the state machine mapper, which grabs it from the stream, applies it to the state machine, and there's the same that prints and runs from one line. So what this example here has, even though it looks very simple, is it goes definitely through the network stack, through the serialization stack, through everything, because the routing between the different cores is not just putting it in the list for somebody, but in order to have this really well behaved and back pressure, this goes through the local network stack here. So we can actually see, even in this example, a little bit what is that proof that you can expect from the here. So let's run this example here. So what this should give us, it should not print the events anymore, but it should print an alarm once in a while. Okay, starting the cluster, and yeah, so we're not seeing any alarms. Maybe I'm not generating any illegal state transitions at this point. Let me actually have a quick look. As I said, it's a pretty risky decode,
That's fine.
Okay, thanks so much. No, it was actually doing this, I just was looking at the result. Fine. That makes sense. So the results go to Evernote. So it should go probably with different argument things. The right way. Okay. Yeah, so we're seeing an alarm once in a while about an illegal state transition. So you can see them coming once in a while, and I'm generating actually an illegal state transition once every 10,000 events. So this should give you a rough estimate of what is actually the throughput here. So to make this a little more clear, let me actually activate the logging here for the throughput. So, okay, so it's ramping up, and it just visited at some point here. So what we're seeing here is numbers that are somewhere in the, if you can parse this, is the font okay? Can you read that? It is roughly 1.5 million events per core here. So this is on this core, yeah, it's reaching, including in Java as an application, as said, should roughly 1.5 or so, 6 million in total. Okay, so I guess this.
if you compare these numbers to Storm or so, they or Spark Streaming, I think they're fairly good. But I think the very interesting thing to see here is what actually happens now if we activate this Jenny Lamport snapshotting algorithm. What can we expect there to happen? How much of the hit is the throughput going to take? And so first of all, we tell the system, okay, enable checkpointing. Let's say we checkpoint every second. So that's okay. The state that we're running, we're just running the state machine with this ingress of 4 bytes restore state. I think the state has been encoded in a few bytes. And I mean the number of concurrent state machines generated, I think, goes down to 1,000 or so before they reach during the state and then go away. So the state that we keep around ultimately is a few. Should be not terribly large, so we can actually see how much how fast is the system and just counting these checkpoints. So what we want is we want to get the exact response guarantees with respect to the state. So that means whenever we draw a checkpoint, we actually want to use a different state to be part of the checkpoint. So we just tell the system to implement. How to take this function into account by implementing here the function checkpointed, and what we checkpoint is just that state. Okay, so is that right? That was right. Okay, so all I did here is add this interface, and then okay here. And what I need to do now is tell the system, okay, when you run a checkpoint, what do we actually want to be in the checkpoint? So in this case here, it's very simple. We just tell, okay, take the state. In our case, your state is the state of the state machine. And once I've recovered the state, how do I do this? When I recover the state, the assumption that now is we bring up a new instance of that state machine mapper, so it's going to have an empty map. So what this basically means here is I'm adding the state that I get for recovery to my yet empty map, and that's basically it. So now the user-defined state takes part in the snapshotting. Let's run this again and see what the numbers are. This is now actually checkpointing into the master. There's also spawn in the background. Okay, give a second to ramp up, and yeah, I think you'll see that the numbers are not vastly different here. At this point, it's in this local mode, the way it's configured by default, it's checkpointing into the memory of the coordinator. So the state here is in total, it's a few megabytes of size, so it can checkpoint every second to the memory of the coordinator. The state checkpointing mechanism is pluggable, so you can also tell it checkpoint to the file system, and the file system could be something like HDFS, then you're not going to see the same throughput because HDFS does not keep up with it. If you make the file system tachyon, you're going to see a good throughput because it keeps up with a better rate. And it's an internal API right now. This is a backend for the state, so you can actually implement, if you go to internal APIs, you can implement your own thing and say, okay, let me throw this into, let's say, Apache Ignite, a distributed main memory store, a main memory key value store, or whatever else you have that can keep up with better, let's say, write throughput rates. And we're trying to expose this in future versions in a nicer way. Then it's an internal API, it's usable, but like most internal APIs, it's polished. So what we want to do in the next version is polish it a bit and expose it, and also give it a way to say, okay, snapshot is an asynchronous fashion, so start the writing, and while the writing, I continue with the processing. Once you're done with the writing, you're actually going to give me a notification. And then I know that the state is actually persistent, but I can continue processing and just not have this checkpoint committed before it's actually persistent. So you can say I'm writing it, it's in the memory of the first code, and then I go on. But I cannot really rely on this checkpoint before, let's say, two other nodes also have taken a replica. But this doesn't have to stop the stream, right? This can happen in the background. The only thing that you lose is that you fall back to a checkpoint earlier. But that's actually. No, it will, because the only checkpoint that you consider is the one where you have to. Okay, good, interesting question. So you can have multiple of these checkpoints in progress at the same time. Assume you're coming from Kafka, you have multiple markers in the Kafka stream where you initiate a checkpoint, right? The latest one that you injected is something that may have replicated one node only, but not too many. So you're having those as a pending checkpoint,
And in case of a failure, you're not falling back to the pending checkpoint, but the previous one. So you're actually falling back one marker earlier to Kafka. Let's say instead of being 1 second, you're falling back 2 seconds. But with the added benefit that between the checkpoints, you did not block for the order to receive a replica of your state. So yeah, it doesn't really impact the exact ones. It only impacts how much the confirmation for checkpoints is trailing behind. Yeah, I mean, we can talk about this offline, but it's
yeah.
Actually, yeah, that is a really...
It's really hard to get exactly once, right? Even this last meeting. Like, it depends on your data,
your checkpoint, all the semantics of that, right? So, yeah. Yeah, I mean, you're right in that the backend for your checkpoint tool has to be able to give you certain, let's say, messages or certain parameters.
I mean, that's one way to really ensure, right?
Yeah, but it does not have to be transactional on individual records. It can be, I mean, a file system is transactional in the sense of you write a load into a file and or HFS, once you close it and it comes back, it is committed, right? The good thing is, because this can happen in the background, as you can see, you don't necessarily need to wait for this. You only cannot mark this state as consistently available. Okay, the point I wanted to show you is that the it's not going to zoom into the console. Because we do the checkpoints asynchronously, right? There's never a block in between starting a checkpoint being in progress, throwing the state somewhere, but the stream can actually continue processing while other messages are still in flight, and it will only later acknowledge the offsets in the source. You can actually get very good guarantees without the without actually blocking the stream or taking too much of it in the photographs. And then in order to get more tolerance. Okay, here's so much that was a bit of a toy example because I was just generating the data. Let's put a real message here in between. Let's put Kafka in between. So instead of reading the data from my generated source here, let me read it from Kafka. So the difference for that is that I'm not creating the stream here as a generated stream, but creating again. I'm using the Kafka adapter from Flink for that. And the Kafka adapter here is written to integrate, to let Kafka take place in this distributed snapshotting. Okay, so this is a simple way of just configuring the minimal bits that you need for Kafka, the zookeeper address, the group in which you are, the topic that you want to consume, and this is a simple serializer I just wrote for to give to Kafka in order to turn byte messages into this case class. So taking this Kafka stream now. I think the topic should be empty. Maybe it contains a little bit of training data from my last test run before showing that here. So let's see what is in Kafka right now. If we actually see some illegal transitions. As we start. Okay, so yeah. Now what we're seeing here is output is that the checkpoint coordinator is actually triggering, committing checkpoints all the time. All the checkpoints are pretty uninteresting because they're all going to contain a disponibility state in the same all set in Kafka. So let me start another program that actually produces pushes some data into Kafka. So okay. Yeah, so I'm running these four Kafka partitions here on this node right on this system right now against a temp directory on a VM or a shitty disk. So the throughput that Kafka gets here is not very good, but that's not something to hold against Kafka. It's really my setup here, okay? Yeah, so this is basically the speed at which the producer can push data into Kafka at this point in time. So we should not really see any illegal state transitions here because once every 10 million elements doesn't really. Okay, so we can also take a bit of stress out of Kafka because once we stress it that heavily, the commits take a while. And what we can do now is we can, let's say, trigger them inserting an illegal state transition here. And we should actually see that this gets immediately reflected on the other side. So the latency is in this case almost instantaneously. Let me actually shut down this generator here. One
hopefully it works also from this command line, because I have no idea how to make these windows stand next to each other in IntelliJ. So if I can do this here. Let's see if it works. Okay. Yeah, let's push a few events per second to the cockpit here, and let's see how fast. Yeah. Okay. Well, as soon as we inject a new state transition here in the other side, the streaming program is okay. No. Okay. It's picking it up fairly fast. So it's basically the latency that you see here is more or less Kafka's latency. The latency of the things is almost negligible here, because yeah, but. There's actually not a lot that could introduce latency on the Flink side. It's buffering the records a little bit. It has something like, I think by default, a 1500 millisecond timeout in the network state. So it's trying to batch up records as soon as it didn't. It wasn't able to do a full buffer within 100 milliseconds. It's going to flush partial buffers. So this is sort of the latency that we can also tune this. We can make this lower. This hits the throughput a little bit, but you can make sure that the latency that the network sort of gets goes down in case you have very low data rates. And this is one knob. If other than that, there's not a lot of elements that hit latency. There's nothing. The stream is not blocked by checkpoint. It's not blocked by media measures. Okay. That's basically it. So the From we can get with Flink itself, we can get fairly high numbers. If we have a consumer that can actually push the numbers at the same speed. If the data comes, we can demo this here with a generator. If you have a cluster where you can give more resources to Kafka, or you're not paying big time latency for that. It's it actually keeps the latency down. Do we have a demo where we can use batch as well as stream? So I can show you batch programs here. So there are examples that are pure batch, there are examples that are pure stream. There may be an example that actually does both. So there's the what you can do is you can do these they're called like co-operations right now. That's not the most intuitive name, we have to come up with a new one, but what they basically boil down to is you define an operation over a stream and you can connect a batch data set as an additional input. So what this will do is first execute a batch code part of the program and taking this data set and putting it into the streaming program. And you can inside the streaming program then use that. So you can use that to, for example, load a batch data set, you can reprocess it in a batch equation and then make it available in the streaming program for example, evaluate streams against that if it is a model. One of the next steps that we're looking into is what is a nice abstraction to give to actually tell the system to periodically refresh this batch data set or to periodically re-execute this batch program. Yeah. It is more an issue of what is the right way to expose this to the user than a problem of how to realize that with the system, because in the first version we just did this, you just asset of the out, trigger this again, and that was not interesting to know, but because usually when you re-execute it, you actually change parameters, or you refer to a different file or whatever. So it's a bit of a way of where do you want to integrate? How do you integrate this with your real infrastructure? A lot of people that re-execute these programs actually refer to some sort of metadata store that tells them what is the latest thing to refer to and so on. So it's really not that interesting unless you have an integration with that. So that is something we are trying to work on. What do people want to do with that? So if you have a very good use case with that, I mean, just come to us and tell us how this, what would this look like? Yeah. So you mentioned exactly once, and in the RPC world, usually exactly once means that that is executed once, right? We are saying, I believe we're saying something else, right? When you have a failure and it goes back to a checkpoint.
Okay, yeah, so this is interesting, right? So what does exactly once mean actually here? I think it's very worthwhile actually defining this, because
I think the exactly once we're referring to is very similar to exactly once in Spark. It basically means you execute something in case something fails, you have to re-execute it. So you're actually executing it twice, but you're executing it rolled back on a consistent state. In Spark at the beginning of the mini batch, or at least at the beginning of the snapshot. So whatever you're computing is going to reflect everything exactly once. Like Robert's example, if what you're doing is a counter, and you have added elements to the counter, and then you have a failure, you will make sure that the counter goes back exactly to the point consistent to before the last checkpoint. You will go Kafka exactly back to that point before that checkpoint. So you'll replay the exact same elements, and you will eventually reset the counter to the same value. This does give you determinism if your operations are deterministic. If your operations are non-deterministic, this may on the recovery run compute something different than on the original one. So this is eventually true for almost everything. And if you think about MapReduce, actually, it's the same thing. The second time you run a mapper, it will only then really work if there's sort of determinism in the operation, otherwise it will not compute the same thing. There are ways to get around this, but I think they really require very, very fine transactions.
Your operation has to be either mode, right? For that to work. And you are replaying, you can replay, and you shouldn't have any side effect of your operation, which is the case for MapReduce. It's a final data set, it's immutable state.
Yeah, okay. Okay, very, very good. Yeah, if you, I mean, the exactly what's out of the box refers to everything that is happening in Flink managed state and everything, right? As soon as you interact with anything with state outside the system, exactly once can only then work if the outside world participates in this, right? So what you have is certain hooks where you can take part in the, where operations can take part in the checkpoint. So your function that takes, where do I have it here? This function that is checkpoint, right? What I can do is I can also tell it to be a checkpoint. How do you do this with Scala? Is it just a comma or is it with another width? Okay, I'm just going to explain it because I don't think I'm going to find it here. Oh no, here it is. Right. It's, you can implement also, you can add more interfaces to your function like checkpoint committer and so on, which means that every time you do successful checkpoints, you get a notification that this part has just been checkpoint. You can use this to synchronize with the outside world. Let's assume you're sending out emails, right? So what you do is you're staging, you're just creating a set of emails that you want to send, and then on checkpoint commit, what you actually do is you send them out. And that means only if the state is never going to be rolled back to before. So you would not send, okay, oh, let me just make sure I send this right. Only when you're sure that you're never going to go back before that, then you're going to send out the email. This is what you need to do if you interact with the outside world. You can think of it like that. If you're inserting into a database, you're inserting every time, and once the checkpoint is done, you want to do a group commit into the database and say, now that I'm sure that I don't fall back to anywhere before this, now this is it. So yeah, you have to do a little bit of cooperation with the outside world if you want exactly what's to be reflected in the outside world. Out of the box, exactly what's is reflected in all the states inside them. Yeah. Okay, so if do we have a whiteboard here or something like that? Maybe we do. Is that a good idea to draw that, or let's try it, because I'm not sure we can. There we go. I would say that's Kafka, right? So we're going to have events A, B, C, D, E, F. For sake of simplicity, we're just collecting them all as our state. So at the end, no matter what the failures are, we want to have a state that contains A, B, C, D, E, F. That's what we want to have. Yeah, but we want to have the other examples.
receive. It's going to receive A and going to, let's say, put A into the stage. And it's going to receive B. It's going to put B into the stage. And then the system decides to do one of these snapshots. So what it does is it injects a barrier here. If this is Kafka, then all these elements have a well-defined offset, right? So let's say this is offset 1, 2, 3. So after we have element B, what we know is the last offset of Kafka that we process is 2. So we're going to inject the barrier here. And what the Kafka source is going to do, it's going to acknowledge as it's part of the checkpoint. Let's say here's the master. It's going to acknowledge 2. It says, okay, as part of this checkpoint, I have been up to 2 in Kafka, right? Then the barrier is going to flow through here. The barrier is eventually going to hit this operator, and by the time, because the barrier flows strictly in line with the elements, by the time it reaches the operator, it will have pushed A and B before it, and it will have made sure that A and B are in the state. And it will have made sure by the time that this barrier has hit the operator, maybe C and D are already on the wire or something, right? Because they're just falling. But as this barrier flows to the operator, it knows that exactly A and B are in the state and C and D not, because that's how it was injected, and that is exactly in line with number 2 offsetting Kafka. So what it does then, it says, okay, I'm making this a part of my state checkpoint. Let me say this is wherever the state goes right now. Like we said before, it can be the memory of the coordinator, it can be a system or whatever. So this is going to be in there as this state. And then the barrier goes on, and let's say here's the sink, it's in here. By the time the barrier is here, maybe C and D are reflected in the state. But C and D are not in here, right? So this here is strictly A and B. Because it was a snapshot copy drawn at the point in time when the barrier was fought through with A and B. Okay, then at some point the barrier is going to reach the sink, and the sink is going to acknowledge the checkpoint, and then we're going to treat this entire thing as one consistent unit. Offset number 2 in Kafka having reflected A and B in the state, right? So by the time this is acknowledged, maybe we have been up to E here. Maybe, right? So we have E and A here, and let's say then we do a failure. So we're going to lose the state, we're going to lose whatever was here on the wire, we've been to Kafka offset 5 or so. And what the system does on recovery, it brings up a fresh instance of this operator. And it's going to initialize it with the state that was associated here with the checkpoint, so with AB. And it's going to reset Kafka back to number 2, and Kafka is going to pick up again after offset 2, right? So you're going to start replaying from here again, so you're going to start replaying C, D, E, F.
We're assuming here that Kafka is at least once, right? So you can create duplicates, so...
Yeah, Kafka can create duplicates, but whenever you pull an element from Kafka, you're going to get an offset. The offset that is associated with the element, and that does not change across files, right? Exactly, yeah. So every partition is doing this independently, right? So partition 0, 1, 2, 3, they're all going to their own offsets. So what will happen is we're going to reconnect to Kafka. We're not telling Kafka, okay, replay what you think we left off. We're going to request exactly to replay from there. Kafka once in a while introduces a duplicate, but the good thing is you recognize the duplicates, because let's assume Kafka did an error here and would give us B and 2 again. And we internally know that, okay, we've actually reached offset 2 already, so we're just going to drop them. So when we restore...
Where do you drop that? So you do that in plain?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So the source is also going to maintain... the source is always... Okay, from Kafka you never receive an element individually, but you're always receiving this pair of both, right? The element and the actual offset in the Kafka partition. Yeah, so we basically check this one, this offset as well. We're making this part of the checkpoint and we restore it to 2, and Kafka gives us B and 2 again, which is both B, and then continue with what was on the offset.
What if in between you're writing the checkpoint thing and then Kafka breaks that you still have not recorded 2? It's a possibility, right?
Yeah, so if in between taking... Okay, hang on. What you want to do is you want to say about if we actually fail before having recorded 2 here. Say again?
Yeah, actually, this happening in reality, it's hard to keep up, but...
Yeah, so if we if before we recorded this tool here, something fails, right? Then the latest consistent one is actually here, and an empty statement. And this is the part that you call back to recovery.
So up there, this is state within the system. Checkpoints, right?
Yeah.
We are not talking about writing something to an external system.
Exactly.
It gets interesting when you write something to an external system. So in this case,
yeah.
Yes, you will not lose any data, you will definitely not get any data from Kafka, it will work.
Yeah.
But let's suppose you store this offset in Kafka itself.
So I mean on the Kafka source side I think this works, right? You're not getting any duplicate from Kafka, you're not getting any duplicates in this state, right? So but let's assume that what we want to do is we want to consistently inject this into true. The data is, yeah, that's
it.
So then there's a very good point. We're actually going to have a very good point now. And you're going to see there's a slight limitation in what you can do there right now. I mean, with Kafka, it's not working because Kafka doesn't have a transaction at this point. Right? So there's really nothing. I think this is the main reason why, for example, Sunset cannot do the second one.
That's the point.
You cannot really have transactions in the second one. Yeah. Exactly. You would need to do transactions, yeah. So what you can do is the following. It requires a bit of work of extra work in the user code. But what you can do is the following. Let's assume we're this checkpoint here again, right? We have two here, we have A, B in the state, let's say C and D and so on are in there, but we have taken at this variable in the state, and we want to make sure A and B is in here. Okay, so what we can do is we inject this and at a certain point in time, whenever the user code here gets the call, okay, commit this transaction, it's going to get the Flink generated checkpoint ID, right? So the first thing you do is you transactionally write into some field here in some extra field in the table, you're going to write, okay, the last committed checkpoint that I have is you're making a transaction in here where you say, okay, I have those elements, I'm writing this, and in this extra table I'm going to write the transaction ID, right? And then you're committing this explicitly, right? And then you're actually good, and then you're acknowledging this back. So but what this means is, if you actually at some point, if you then fail before you have acknowledged this back to the system, right?
Yeah.
Then you know you have actually committed. You have committed this part, this checkpoint already, even though the commit message did not reach Flink.
It's gone. It's committed. Right? Exactly.
The next time you commit, you also have to check, did I actually commit this checkpoint ID? So what you have to do is you have to do this two-phase commit operation with the expected block. So you can actually do this. I mean, the interfaces allow you to implement all these things in order to get that. It requires a little bit of manual work.
That's why I said that it's not exactly what I'm saying.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying. It's not exactly.
Hello? Okay. When people say exactly once out of the box, it refers to everything that is stream processor, internal stream processor, managed state, and so on, which is actually, for many things that's fairly powerful, right? I mean, for this application, all it will mean is you may actually generate the alert duplicate, right? If you would have something like at least once, you would actually reprocess an event into some state that would then mean an illegal state transition that wouldn't be there. So you're not going to see this. You're not going to see false positives because the only state that is here required to be consistent is the one inside the system. So inside system, exactly once gets important. For many cases, extremely far. If you want outside world incorporation, then you have to do some sort of two-phase commit interaction with the outside world.
So, as a strict definition, you could only say
okay.
Not
the end. Okay, fair enough. Then let me rephrase it. Data sinks, wherever they go, are only exactly once if you help cooperate. Everything that is not a sink in terms of interacting with the outside world is an inside. Okay? Is that a fair definition? Okay, cool. Alright. Yeah. Yeah, I think you're right, it's important to talk about it because people tend to throw out these words and not really define what they mean. It's true, but I think now we understand.
No, the patchwork, so you're not exactly.
Yeah. I hope we want to be honest. So if we're actually saying things that you think are overstated or are not mentioning some details like this here, then that's very nice.
Do you think that
these
sort of walls
I mean, right-hand blocks are one way of saying you can use them to sort of stage this and sort of instead of doing the disk commit, but they tend to come at an extra cost, right? Because you're doing things into the right-hand block and then move them into where they actually go. So you tend to be able to use them, but they come at a different cost. Yeah.
So, do you have a way to provide a sort of a smooth migration from either Spark or Storm, just plug and play?
Yeah, so Robert mentioned this, there's, I'm not sure if it's merged already, there was an open pull request for a Storm compatibility layer. It does not do 100% exactly Storm compatibility, mainly because...
because a lot of applications or use cases,
right now they're running on top of
Storm Spark.
Yeah.
But people would like to, they don't need to write any part of the code, they need to plug in via system and run.
Yeah, so for Storm this should work for a good set of operations. I think there's some operations that are not yet implemented, and especially in case of a failure, Flink is recovering failures differently than Storm is recovering them. So you're going to get this sort of recovery on the Storm program rather than Storm's tuple and acknowledgement timeout based replay, right? So this may, in the end, in cases of failures, behave slightly differently. Just because we don't want to re-implement Storm's memory.
Yeah,
so I think actually this is nicer.
That will be definitely rapidly increase your adoption rate.
Yeah, so like I said,
you are quickly expanding your user.
Yeah, that's a very good
point. That's not a lot of science,
That's
like a integrity issue.
Yeah. That's a good comment, thanks. Yeah.
Okay, I'm ready.
that's a good one of the questions open. That was a very good comment. That was a very long Q&A, but thanks for being with us.
Thanks, Rich.
Well, thanks guys for coming, really appreciate it. Thanks again for Cash Data for hosting us tonight. You guys follow up again with Dev mailing list, YouTube mailing list, give us a shout out. We'd love to hear from you guys, and if you guys want to give a pull request contributions or transaction based, anyone processing, we'd definitely love to see it. Thank you very much, have a good night. Thanks guys.